Hello friends, I'm FIDE instructor Atul Dahale and welcome to my YouTube channel. Today I am back with yet another beautiful game for you. Yes, today's game is very special because it is already being termed as the game of the year. Yes, the sacrifice, the queen sacrifice which was played in this game by Dubov is such a beautiful sacrifice that you will be in awe. Like, how can you someone play like this kind of a chess in modern day era? Yes, when I first time looked at this game, I felt like I am living in some kind of 19th century, but to be honest, this game is played in the 21st century and we are going to look at this game as big fans. So guys, this game was played between Dubov and Karjakin Sergey in Russian Championship Superfinals in the final round, that is the 11th round. And this game was very important in terms of standings also, because Karjakin Sergey lost here and Nepo managed to win the championship. So without further delay, let's get started with this game. And before we go further, I would like to tell you that don't forget to like this video and subscribe to my channel if you are new here. So the game started with e4. Dubov was white here, Karjakin Sergey was black. He played e5, knight f3, knight c6, bishop to c4. Well, very normal, bishop c5, c3, gaiko piano opening, you can say. Black played knight f6 and now d4. Now you might feel like, okay, this is going to be very normal opening and everything, but after e into d4, Dubov prepared a big surprise for his opponent. He played b4, which is not that much common move in this position. Everybody knows, even like small kids also know this thing, that c into d4 is the common move. After that, bishop b4 will be played. And here white has two main options, knight to c3 and bishop to d2. And there are many games, countless of games have been already been played in this position. After, let's suppose you can play knight into e4, then castle, then bishop into c3, b into c3, and now after d5, bishop d3, this is the main theory, you can say. There are multiple possibilities in this position also, so I'll not go into detail. But the b4 was a big surprise for Karjakin here, and he played bishop to b6. Okay, and after this white played e5. Well, the knight is being attacked, so knight goes to e4 square. There was also one more possibility in this position from black side, that was d5, directly attacking the bishop on c4, because if you capture e into f6 in this case, then d into c4, and I will say that this position is quite double-edged. Means, okay, black has these two pawns here, white is also quite good, and after queen, let's suppose you might play something like knight a5, then queen e2 check, bishop to e6, then f into g7, rook to g8, and black should be fine in this position, because he'll be playing queen d7 followed by long castle, and white will also be going for this. Some kind of this kind of play will happen and the game will go on. So I'll not go into that much detail here. Knight e4 was played, and now what will you play? Well, you played bishop to d5. Dubov is playing very creative chess. He's a very creative player, and I feel like he has shown in this game like why he is considered as one of the best youngsters or upcoming stars in the elite chess. Okay, so bishop g5, directly going for the attack here. Previously in database, there are only two games which were being played here, that was like in 2019-94. Then in those games castling was done, but here he goes for bishop g5, and now already we are at a very new position, brand new position, you can say. Black played knight to e7, now white castled, and you can see like the way white has played is completely amazing. But wait for it, we are going to see many fireworks, many surprises in this position. And now black played h6. Okay, fine, white plays bishop to h4, then castle, and now he plays rook to e1. As they say, like, we need to bring our pieces as quickly as possible in the game, and white is definitely doing his job pretty well. He has developed his all pieces, you can say, bishop, this knight, this bishop, this rook, everything is super fast developed. But black is yet to develop his bishop and this rook, as well as the queen on d8. Must be feeling a little bit sad because he's not having any squares, and the knight on e7. Well, you must feel like, okay, what he must be playing? He must be feeling like, oh man, I don't have any squares, although I am sitting there on e7, but I cannot really move in this position. So black plays queen to e8, trying to make some room for the knight. Bishop is being attacked, so bishop goes to b3 square, and now black tries to open up the position. He plays a5 in this position. Okay, he needs to do something, that's why he plays a5. And now the surprising move, which is, you can say, the prelude for the sacrifice which we are going to see, the beautiful queen sacrifice which happened in the game, which completely changed everything. The move was bishop to f6. Well, white is offering the sacrifice here, but really why? He cannot really capture it here, right? It is very simple that the rook will be capturing the knight on e7 very soon, and black's king is completely exposed in that case. So bishop f6 is just like the luring thing. He is not going to do anything about it. a4 has been played. Bishop goes to c4 square, and now knight goes to g6 square. And now Dubov, who was very sharp, tactically very sharp, he plays queen d3, setting up his eyes towards the knight on g6, because the pawn on f7 is pinned here, so queen into g6 is the direct threat. And after queen into g6, queen into g7, and there will be a checkmate. So black plays d5, trying to get his piece in the game. The bishop on c8 is now opened up. He plays e into d6, bishop comes to e6, and now Karjakin thought like, okay, no problem, my pawn on f7 is no longer pinned, and I can definitely protect the knight here on g6. Even if bishop into e6 is played, after f into e6, queen cannot capture on g6 because the queen on e8 is supporting everything. The pawn on e6 is also being supported, and the position should be okay for black. But here in this position, Dubov has already seen a beautiful queen sacrifice. You can say spectacular, and that move is already, you can say like, he gifted himself surprise, like the Christmas surprise, very early. Queen into g6. Okay, now this move is obviously must be played. You cannot just capture the bishop here because queen into g7 is a check and mate. So f into g6, and after rook into e6, you can understand that even though white has sacrificed the queen here in this position, he has plenty of compensation for the sacrificed queen. Here black played queen f7, and now he captures bishop into c3. He doesn't need to worry about anything. He just goes back because he believes that in this position, the bishops are pretty good in this position because they are aiming directly towards black's king side. Okay, so black goes away from the pin. So he plays king to h8, and now he goes rook to e4. Now the queen is being attacked, so queen needs to move somewhere, so queen moves to f5 square, and now the rook again goes to 7th rank. Okay, after going to the 7th rank, because earlier he was not able to do that because bishop on c4 was hanging, now the pawn on g7 is attacked. So from this moment onwards, I'll just tell you, like, white played flawlessly and he won the game in a very smooth manner. So the next moves are quite a bit, you can say, like the matter of technique, and I'm not going to talk about it much because they are spectacular. They don't need any kind of big explanation. So rook g8, trying to support the pawn on g7, and now he captures the rook on g8. Rook into g8, and now he captures the pawn on d7. Obviously the pawn on d6 was hanging, so he captures here, and the white has a passed pawn in this position. He plays queen to c2, attacking the bishop as well as the pawn on f2, but he doesn't need to worry because the rook on a1 is supporting everything. There is no back rank checkmate. The pawn on c7 needs to be protected. He plays bishop to e5. Still the rook on e7 as well as the bishop on e5 are keeping the eye on g7 pawn, and this pawn is a trump card in the position. So black captures bishop into f2, no problem. He plays king to h1, bishop goes back to safe, like here pawn on c7 is being attacked, and now he makes a room for his king. He plays h3 so that if this rook comes in the game at any point, there should not be back rank checkmate. Very clever, right? So king to h7, and now, as they say, like, bring all the toys to the party. That's why here Dubov plays rook to e1. Very simple chess. He is not hurrying for anything. He is not trying to get the material or anything. He is just trying to bring more and more pieces in the game. And now all white's pieces are in the game, and black is completely not having any good moves here. He plays a3, and now he plays one prophylactic move. He is playing waiting move. He doesn't need to do anything. He plays king h2, getting away from all the checks and everything from the back rank, because this rook is going to go up at any point. Black played g5, and a knight goes to d4 square. Obviously the knight is attacking the queen here, but there are other threats also, that he wants to play knight e6 followed by capturing the pawn on g7. He plays queen c4. Okay, no problem. So knight jumps to this square, f5. The pawn on g7 is being attacked. He captures queen into b4, attacking the rook on e1 as well as the rook on e7. But we don't need to worry about anything. The rook on e1 goes to c1 square. Now the threat is obviously to play c8. Black is completely helpless. Okay, he plays king g6, attacks the knight on f5. But okay, rook into g7, simple move, king into f8, and now rook into g8. The pawn is going to queen, so here black played bishop into c7, and now bishop into c7. For the queen, now he has three pieces, that to two rooks and bishop. So the queen sacrifice which happened in the game turned out to be a great, great sacrifice for white, and now he went on to win in a very smooth way. Queen b2, rook c5 check. King goes to e4 square, and now he plays rook to d8. The idea is obviously to play rook e5 check followed by rook to f8, and it is going to be a checkmate very soon. So black needs to give up his queen. That's why black resigned in this position, although he has extra queen on the board, but there are plenty of pieces from the white side, and that's why this game ended in a beautiful way. So this game reminds us the way 19th century players like Morphy and all those players used to play. And I hope you enjoyed this video. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like this video and subscribe to my channel if you are new here. We'll be meeting very soon with some new video with something new topic. Till then, take care and goodbye.